Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Oh, lesson is a reading from Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 to 7 and 15 to 16. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers." Abraham fell face down, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abraham. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you." God also said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of all nations. King of peoples will come from her." Word of the Lord.
Thank you. second lesson is a reading from Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd of his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be shamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." Word of God.
Seated at the right hand of the Father. You will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God, Father of all mercies, we are your worthy servants, give you humble thanks
for all your goodness and loving kindness.
have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world the knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Start a new tradition for the second century to get all of that going. I am indebted to my colleague Gary Gress, to the choir of Church Front School for their willingness to give this a shot and to ask our friends from the parish of the Church of the Good Samaritan in Paoli to come be with us here this evening. And I know they do so with heavy hearts. We've all in the deanery been praying for Richard Morgan and his family, and for the parish that is the Good Samaritan. We also want to say a special note to Colin Holland for his work at the Oregon Consul, so Gary can keep everybody together as we go along. The evening time, I don't want to take much time in homily, but the evening time is a Lenten season every day. It offers us a chance to stop the busy work in which we've been engaged and to take something of a strategic retreat before the evening comes, before we lay our head down on the pillow, praying that we'll wake again in the morrow and start all over again. But the wise person spends a little time in reflection on the day that has passed, not just on the toil of their labor, but on the graces that abound on every side, both human and divine. Those graces that make our life possible, those graces that forgive all the wrongs that we may have committed, those graces that help us lift ourselves in joy and celebration when we have cause to do so. And when we reflect just a little bit deeper, that the presence of God sits with us as wherever we go, wherever we are, helping us become more and more fully who we've been created to be. But that takes some time to figure out. And again, the wise person spends a little time in retreat, not the retreat of surrender, not the retreat of giving up, but a tactical moment of taking a little step back to see the view again, anew, of what lies ahead, to take some assessment of the strength and the courage that's needed to get forward on that journey. Jesus and his disciples are often on retreat, often in prayer and contemplation. And even there, they don't seem to get it right, where Peter has it all figured out as to who Jesus is, who God should be in his life, and how his life will be delivered by his own vision of what that is. Here again, God comes to us in the quietness of Lent, in the stillness of the evening, and reminds us to let God be God. And that where God moves us and allows us to have breath and sustenance on this earth, to give our labor on behalf of others, then we might find not only God but ourselves in the true calling of who we are to be. High schools are not necessarily moments of retreat. Boys in our midst and their brothers and sisters all around the world are on their way forward, just taking stock of all the things that they have to do and all the brightness that awaits them if they can figure out how to apply that, not just to get a job, but to be part of a community, to make that community sing the way we've been singing this evening. If we can get that right in our educational moment in this generation, then we might do our part to help the world turn again, not just on the day, but turn again towards that peace which we seek, that sense of equity and justice of what Jesus constantly speaks and invites us to do our part to make a reality, not just a dream, even when we prepare at night to dream. So this Lenten season and this evening, on the first of an evensong in this place, as we begin a second century of dedication to boys and the next generation that will come after them, let our strategic retreat be for the next advance, for that next part of human interaction that God gives us the capacity to do, to make something of that. To make something of that for the weakest in our world, the most destitute, the most lonely, the most vulnerable, that they too may be lifted by a special service, not just in a chapel, but of our common humanity extended to one another. This God has given us the task to do. And while we retreat this evening, let us also wake tomorrow prepared to do it. Amen.
Thank you.
stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Amen.
Guests are invited to join Lizette and me over at the house right behind the chapel. There's a path just here to the east, a chance for a little refreshment and to greet the choir before you head home if you'd like to do that. We hope you will.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.